Baby, that's all right. What's going on, community? Welcome back to First Frequency of One, the Shock Metaphysics. Yes, the ball guy. It's me, and it's Tuesday. I am so excited to have back with us Minister Imhotep Al-Kalabon. What's going on, my beloved? How are you?
Roots and culture. Glad to be with you, Reverend Shock, and glad to be talking to our people. About some things that are important to us, some things that have kind of dropped off the map, but, you know, they're still there, and we need to look at it. We need to look
at it. I'm looking forward to this one because this is a very sacred book and work by one of our beloved elders and scholars, Dr. Wade Nobles.
Yes. So
when did you come across and come about this level of work?
So Dr. Wade Nobles, I've known him since the late 70s, early 80s.
Wow.
And I was never a direct student of his, but he's had a lot of association with Wolsey community. And I just loved his lectures, loved his books. And I went to one of Wolsey Oakland's anniversaries, and he was the keynote speaker. And that's when I purchased his book.
Wow.
And then a couple of years later, I was able to get him to autograph it.
Oh, no, that's nice.
Yeah, yeah.
That's nice. That's awesome. Is it Sakhu or Sakhu? Or is it either tomato, tomato?
I've been saying Sakhu, Sakhu, S-A-K-H-U.
Okay. And what does that translate and what does that mean?
So that's what we're going to be talking about. It has a few different translations. Okay. And it is a posture that relates to something that Colin Kaepernick was doing.
Ah. Oh, this is going to be quite interesting, is it not? Oh, doody, doody. So we're going to get into the epistemology and the etymology of this amazing word, but also this amazing science, sacred science, I should say. Shall we launch our PowerPoint?
Okay.
And get rocking and rolling here for the community?
Yeah. So
on the screen, and there we are, or yeah. Almost are. There we are. All right, here we go. I'm going full screen, community. There it is. Seeking and performing the Sakhu.
Yeah. Excellent. So give thanks. So a lot of people contributed to this presentation. Dr. Obinga, a person that I always communicate with in Kemet, who likes to be nameless. And so let's get started. Seeking the Sakhu. And Dr. Obinga consulted Dr. Nobles and said, really, it's more like performing the Sakhu. But we're going to talk about it. So, and this is the posture. This is the posture. And all of us have seen this in one form.
Yes.
We've seen this.
Yes.
And here is his Anpu doing it. There's a Per'a doing it. And there's Hor or Heru doing it. So.
Oh my gosh.
Now,
wow.
Colin Kaepernick, you know, and the reason why he was doing it, all these people, you know, died at the hands of law enforcement.
Mm-hmm.
You know, and he started wearing his fro like Angela Davis.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
Right? So we have this brother, and this brother. We have Freddie Gray, Michael Brown, Eric Gardner. that would be bad enough if it was just these three, but there's people throughout all our history.
Yes, yes.
So Freddie Gray, Michael Brown, Eric Gardner. Now, when I think about these things, Philippe, it brings me back to my own childhood in the 70s. Now, this is Tyrone Guyton, and he was 14 in 1973. I was 14 or 13 in 1973. I just remember us being the same age, and he was shot in the back by Emeryville police. And if you're familiar with the Bay Area, Emeryville is just north of Oakland. And so the police shot him in the back. Mm. And they said the reason why they shot him is because he turned around and had a gun. And so they had to shoot him. But they never found the gun.
Sure.
They never found the bullets. And so the police lab proved that he did not fire a gun. No gun was found. So whenever I think of, whenever these events come out, I go back to this, Tyrone Guyton. And I was able to find this flyer. This flyer goes back. And if you grew up in the 70s, there were a lot of black movies that were coming out. And one of them was Cornbread Earl and Me. Do you remember that movie?
I do. Oh. That was during the black exploitation era.
Yes. And so this movie came out. This is Jamal Wilkes. He was Keith Wilkes at the time. And he was playing for the Warriors, and they had just won their first NBA championship. And this guy here, this is Lawrence Fishburne.
Wow.
Yeah.
That's right.
You know, and
if some of you might not remember, Lawrence Fishburne was what was his character on Welcome Back, Carter? Oh no,
that's Lawrence people. Hilton. Jake.
I'm thinking that's Lawrence Hilton. Lawrence Fishburne, my bad.
Yeah.
No, we just saw.
So he was the father on Blackish. So
right, he was the father on Blackish. But do you remember the movie Deep Cover? That first iteration of Deep Cover.
You know, this is Morpheus. Amazing. This is Morpheus.
This is Morpheus. Yeah.
So this, I think, this is probably his first movie, and you know, you had stars in there like Madge Sinclair, Bernie Casey, remember him?
Bernie Casey, Moses Gunn.
So all these people were in this movie. And what this movie was about is that, okay, this guy was a basketball star in his community, and he was headed to college, and he was playing one day. It was raining. He was just sitting on the court, and the police were chasing somebody. And they mistook him, and they shot and killed him, and then tried to cover it up. That's what that movie was about.
Mm, mm-hmm, mm-hmm.
So, and his name was Cornbread. So Cornbread Earl and Me, and Me was Lawrence Fishburne. So these are things that you know that I relate back to.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm, mm-hmm.
So. The origin of police badges begins with the slave patrol. I found this meme. The system was never broken. It was built this way. You know, people say, well, why is this happening? That's the way it was built. We can't ignore the history. Here's a badge that says slave patrol on it. And then you can compare it to a police officer's badge. So before there was the police, there was the slave patrol. And I found this article by Ben Brokuto. Brocato, excuse me, Brocato, policing, race, and race police, the origin of U.S. police and slave patrols. And here at the bottom, so here is, look what this has on here. Plantation police, Georgetown County, South Carolina, runaway slave patrol, 1858. But if you read in down into the article, it points out that the Charleston Slave Patrol referenced in the passage above, so he talks about it, was founded in 1704. And he cites the references. So if you want to find out more about this particular aspect, sisters and brothers, we can go to this article by Ben Roccato, Policing, Race, and Race Police, the Origin of U.S. Police in Slave Patrols.
Love it. Love it. Great research, Emo.
So now, many of us are familiar with the great psychiatrist. She was a leading child psychiatrist, Dr. Frances Cress Welsing. And she wrote a book that came out in the early 80s. It was called The ISIS Papers, The Keys to the Colors. In that book, these are the table of contents. Cress' theory of color confrontation and racism, white supremacy. She covers a lot of different topics, but I want to move on to this topic here. Chapter 15, again, when these things happen, I go to the ISIS papers, chapter 15, the symbolism, logic, and meaning of justifiable homicide in the 1980s. So that's how old this book is. But these are papers that she had written, you know, beginning in the 70s. These are just she goes into racism and black child and youth inferiorization. Just a tremendous work that she puts forth. But you know, to stay on topic, symbolism, logic, and meaning of justifiable homicide in the 1980s. And then I found this meme. I thought he had a gun. This time I want you to say it with a serious look on your face. You know, and that's what we get. Now, Dr. Welsing, when she would talk about this particular subject, she'd recommend this book by Norm Stamper. And it's called Breaking Rank, A Top Cop's Exposé of the Dark Side of American Policing. And in this book, which came out in like 2005, and these are the table of contents, chapter 8 and 9 deal, so this is chapter 8, Why White Cops Kill Black Men. And chapter 9, Racism in Ranks. This book isn't very expensive. It's worth reading to kind of know what's going on. This is a topic, number 16, I think the language about the police had gotten scrambled because people were saying defund the police. And I don't think that's such a good idea, defund the police, but demilitarizing the police. But anyway, this cop, who was a top cop in Seattle, wrote this book. And chapter 8, chapter 9, Why White Cops Kill Black Men, Racism in Ranks. Now getting back to Brother Colin Kaepernick, Kneeling with 49ers team. So all of these young brothers and sisters getting killed by the police. So he started kneeling while they were singing the national anthem and the flag was being raised. And those of you that recall, this was a this started a controversy, you know, but it caught on around the NFL. Other teams started doing it. So Colin gave his reasons for kneeling. He says, I'm not going to stand up to show pride in a flag for a country that oppresses black people and people of color. That was basically it. You know, I'm not going to honor that, you know, until we change what's going on here. You know, that could be me, that could be my son, that could be my daughter, that could be my wife, that could be anybody. And then this protest went across the pond. In English Premier, you may not know this fully, but I watch a lot of English Premier. My two sons played a lot of soccer, and one of their coaches recommended that they watch soccer on TV. And so we started watching English Premier. And if you watch soccer, it's a very popular sport. It's like playing basketball on a football field. You got to be fit to play soccer. And so it's popular around the world. And these are some great players. Here, this brother here, he plays for Man United, Marcus Rashford. This brother used to play for my son's gonna get me for this. Why can't I think of the team? But anyway, his name is Aubameyang, and he was a top striker. Here we see, the team is Arsenal, and here we see what women. So before the game starts, and even the referee, they would take a knee. Here's some more great players. This brother here, he's from Egypt. This is Mohamed Salah. He's a really a great striker. He has a lot of goals. And then this brother, he plays for Arsenal, Shaka. And so when they before the game starts, everybody takes a knee, and they say, we're doing this to stamp out race, even the referee. So what's the history of that? The English Premier taking the knee. The England national team had been taking a knee since 2020 as part of a worldwide anti-racism movement accelerated by the death of African-American George Floyd at the hands of U.S. police brutality in May of that year. The Premier League players performed the gesture for more than a year before deciding to limit its uses at the start of this season. Three Lions also took the knee before matches at the FIFA World Cup in Qatar. It's what we stand for as a team and have done for a long period of time. And that's what the head coach, this was the English team and at the World Cup, That's what the coach was saying. We feel this is the biggest stage, and we think it's a strong statement that will go around the world for young people in particular to see that inclusivity is very important. So Black Lives Matters, why do football players need? So 2016, Colin Kaepernick opted to kneel during the U.S. national anthem to protest against racism in the country. previously, I didn't know this, he previously would sit on the bench, but he was persuaded to do the kneeling posture, which has been taken up increasingly by a number of players ever since. So the death of Floyd in Minneapolis led to a rise in awareness of Black Lives Matter movement, which was launched in 2013, and the Campaign for Racial Equality, Justice, and Social Change. So the players were taking it up. And, you know, I as I was preparing for this, I was like, I wonder if they're still doing it. Because I watched the English Premier League just started like a couple of weeks ago. And I saw the first game. And sure enough, they were taking a knee. But I had to verify that they were still doing this. And so it says, Premier League captains have confirmed that players will once again take the knee before specific matches during the 2023 and 2024 season to demonstrate their ongoing commitment to fight racism and all forms of discrimination. So that's very interesting. But you know, I don't want to paint a picture. And I have a friend. His name is Tony. We used to work together, and he knew my kids were in the soccer. And he was like, how could you let your kids play soccer and they throw bananas on the field to black players? And this is an example. Now this is a brother. His name is Mario Balotelli. And he's a Ghanaian immigrant to Italy. And he had some health conditions that his family couldn't take over. And so he was adopted by this Italian family. Anyway, he overcame those ailments and became a leading soccer player. And they would throw bananas on the field. And it became a quite a scandal. And here, a major newspaper put this picture or where he's on Big Ben like King Kong swatting soccer balls away. So I don't want to give the impression that everything is all sweetness and light in soccer, but they are trying to address it in certain ways.
Well, one of the things I think is beneficial, Baba Imo, is we normally focus on racism here in America. Mm-hmm. We don't get a chance to really see it and how this wannabe white supreme manifests around the world. So globally, you're looking at, as Dr. John Henrik Clark would say, we have no friends.
Yeah.
Yeah. So thank you for this.
Yeah. So here's Aubameyang again. And Aubameyang was a great striker. I don't know what team he's playing for now. But after he would hit get a goal, he would do a frontal flip and nail it. He would do it like a 10. Anyway, because he was so good, sometimes they were playing this team Tottenham, they would throw bananas on the field. All right, let's move on. Let's leave that section. So the Star Spangled Banner. You know, perhaps not knowing the full lyrics is a good thing. It's one of the most racist, pro-slavery, anti-black songs in the American lexicon. And Facts. you can find a really good story about it in The Root online magazine, theroot.com. Search Star-Spangled Bigotry, The Hidden Racist History of the Star-Spangled Banner. So here's the headline. It was came out in 2016. Star Spangled Banner, Bigotry, The Hidden History of the National Anthem. And so I highlighted these sections just to go over it briefly. To understand the full Star Spangled Banner story, you have to understand the author. Key was an aristocrat, a city prosecutor in Washington, D.C. He was, like most enlightened men of the time, not against slavery. He just thought that since blacks were mentally inferior, masters should treat them more with more Christian kindness. He supported sending free blacks, not slaves, back to Africa, and with a few exceptions, was about as pro-slavery, anti-black, anti-abolitionist as you could get at the time. So that's the person who's writing the Star Spangled Banner. And then he goes on, this article goes on and talks about colonial Marines. And colonial Marines were Marines. There was a battalion of runaway slaves who joined the British Royal Army in exchange for their freedom. So, you know, the British said, hey, if you fight with us, we'll free you from slavery. And so these Marines were not only a terrifying example of what slaves would do if given the chance, but also a repudiation of the white supremacy that men like Key were so invested in. All of these ideas and concepts came together August 24th, 1841, at the Battle of Bladensburg, where Key, who was serving as a lieutenant at the time, ran into a battalion of these brothers. His troops were taken to the woodshed by the very black folks he disdained, and he fled back to his home in Georgetown to lick his wounds. The British troops, emboldened by their victory in Bladensburg, then marched to Washington, D.C., burning the Library of Congress, the Capitol building, and the White House. You can imagine that Key was very much in his feelings, seeing black soldiers trampling on the city he so desperately loved. So, you know, we did something that the people on January 6th did. You know, but we did it for a just cause. And this is that third, so it's the third verse in the Star Spangled Banner. It says, no refuge could save the hireling and slave from the terror of flight or gloom of the grave, and the Star Spangled Banner in triumph doth wave over the land of the free and the home of the brave. So in other words, Key was saying that the blood of all the former slaves and the hirelings on the battlefield will wash away the pollution of the British invaders. So the Star Spangled Banner is as much a patriotic song as it is a diss to black people who had the audacity to fight for their freedom. So by Colin Kaepernick doing that, I mean, most people wouldn't have, I know I wouldn't have, most people wouldn't have, they wouldn't have researched that. They wouldn't have known that. So getting back to what Brother Colin did, you know, what Colin did, his gesture harkens back as ancient and sacred to our people, to African people. Let's talk about it. Here are a few poses. You know what? This pose is even found among the Yoruba. This pose is found in Nigeria. 700 BC, 1200 BC. And in this meme, it's called, whoever put this meme together, the Hero Shango Oath, pose of devotion to heroism ancient indigenous African bio-cultural heritage. Here we have Hor, Heru, or Heru. We have a Per-A, otherwise known as Pharaoh, and Anpu in a jubilation pose. Got their fist up, got their hand on their heart. And sometimes it's called the Hennu pose to show praise or jubilation. It's found in all periods of Kemetic art. To show praise. Look at that brother.
It looks like Kaepernick, don't he?
Phenomenal. Let's see.
Kaepernick looks like him, right? I love it. Yes. Yes.
So I bought Dr. Wade Noble's book at a Wosei anniversary. Here we are back in the day, back a few years ago. And, you know, it's always great to talk to him. He's just, not only is he a outstanding scholar, but he's just a great person to talk to. If you ever get a chance to talk to him, he's just a great brother. So I bought his book, and here's the book. It's called Seeking Sakhu, Foundational Writings for an African Psychology. Wade Noble's Nana Kweku Berku. I can't pronounce the other part. Sorry, Dr. Nobles, but here's this book. And that's what this is saying here in Medu Nature Seeking the Sakhu. So, and then I was talking to Brother Philippe about this picture, and we were trying to get everybody in here. And I asked him, I said, hey, okay, when we took this picture, what were we doing that day? And he said,
oh, is this where I come in?
yeah, this is where you
come. Oh, that's my cue. Doggone it.
Yeah, that's okay. Where you come.
All right. Well, what were we doing that day? I think we had just, I just put it in the chat because I did an interview with Dr. Nobles for, we debuted the Hopi film in Sacramento. And what's the theater?
The Gill Theater.
The Gill Theater. And so we had the event there. And Bobby with, what's the organization? Bobby's on
African Americans for Balanced Health, AAB.
Yeah.
African Americans for Balanced Health. Yep.
So I'm trying to look. So, of course, there's the three kings, you know, Wade Noble's bottom right, Leonard Jeffries in the middle, James Smalls on the left. And then
Sabrina, the songstress. Okay. She's a great singer, by the way. And, you know, you can look her up, Sabrina, the songstress. And this is a couple, and they formed a group called Israel Farms. Yes. And they grow holistic food. This is Brother Chinook and his wife, Sister Judith. And this is like an original member of Wosei Sacramento. This is Sister Bertha Rose. So we stopped and took this picture. And that was when I got my book autographed. By Dr.
That was an amazing time.
Yeah. And so here they are. This is a great shot of them. Dr. Jeffries is also known as Nana Kweku. And then Dr. Nobles and Professor Smalls. All, I mean, not only great scholars, but just great men, great African men. Not too lofty that you can't talk to them. They're very down to earth, but very knowledgeable. they are what Dr. Karinga refers to in his book The Husiya and his book on Mat as a Geru Mat, that they are teachers of teachers. Anyway, moving on. So here's the scene, the Sakhu scene, and you can see it if you look closely here. Here are three priests kneeling in that pose. And this is what Dr. Noble says. He says, I have suggested that a complete and full understanding of African people should be governed by a deep and profound, penetrating search, study, and mastery of the process of illuminating the human spirit or essence, ergo Sakhu Shati. Seeking the Sakhu has been a search for profound and penetrating understanding of the psychology of African people independent of non-African conceptions. Gerald Massey suggested that the word Sakhu meant understanding, the illuminator, the eye, the soul of being, that which inspires. Both Naeem Akbar, another great scholar, and I suggested that psyche, the word in psychology, was probably derived from the comedic term Sakhu. I mean, just that alone, that Sakhu is probably where psyche comes from. In the desire to be accurate in the classification of my seeking the Sakhu, I asked Dr. Theophile Obenga, the foremost living Egyptologist in the world today, to translate the term seeking the Sakhu. Professor Obenga identified a relief from the private tomb at Saqqara from the 9th or 10th dynasty. In interpreting the relief, Professor Obenga pointed out that the scene below the long tabulated list of funeral offerings, there is the Sakhu scene. This scene depicts a lector priest holding a text in his left hand, reciting the appropriate ritual. Directly behind the lector priests are three kneeling lector priests who are chanting the many Sakhu recitations designed to transform the deceased into a glorious spirit or an Akhu. Dr. Obenga noted that the language of ancient Kemet would not say seeking the Sakhu as much as it would say doing the ritual of the Sakhu. Hence, Dr. Obenga suggested that a good translation of seeking the Sakhu would be Irit Her Sakhu, performing the Sakhu. So that's why I've included seeking the Sakhu or performing the Sakhu. So then I reached out to my ubiquitous clandestine informant in Kemet, and I wrote to him, I said, Save, I'm not.
What? Wait a minute. Wait. You just kind of slid all through that just like nobody would notice. Like, you know who I am. Like, wait a minute. There's three things this person is to you, right? He is ubiquitous, he's clandestine, and he's an informant. What's going on here, Emo?
Let me tell you something.
We have our own people on the inside. Is what's going on.
You know what? That's a phrase I stole from Morgan Freeman in Lean on Me.
I'm sorry, community. You know, Emo and I have this relationship. Well, we have things that we love in movies and sayings and phrases And this is one of them. So I'm going to call you up and say, how is my ubiquitous clandestine informant doing today? Oh my gosh.
Yeah, anyway, this is a friend that I met in Kemet, and just when I need to verify some things, you know, I reach out to him, and he usually gets back to me. So I talked about him
before. Yeah, he's an amazing resource. Yes.
Yeah, yeah, but he doesn't want to, like, you know, be no. He doesn't want notoriety, you know. So that's why I've left his name out, you know. But anyway, you know, I asked him, was he familiar with this term, you know, and I told him where it came from. And then he got back to me pretty quickly. And then he said, hey, brother, this is a complex phrase and have so many meanings and layers of interpretation. You can translate it in many different ways. It can translate as seeking the Sakhu, but the term in the block is part of ancient prayers to summon the Aku as the ancestors or celestial beings, spirits of our fathers. Irit meant to see beyond the physical, to go deep in oneself, psych or psychic. So you see how difficult it can be. I'd take the translation seeking the Sakhu. That was what he said. And then he went on. He said, the word in the hieroglyphics as an oath. Notice the man with the hand on his mouth. Also the strongest oath that is something like cross my heart as Akhenaten's oath when he raised the Ankh to his mouth and said, Ankh, I swear on life itself. So, you know, this was on Messenger, and so I left him a voicemail, and he wrote back, anytime, my friend. And by the way, the picture you posted, it's a recall if the ancestors, I think it's suitable in this situation, the original ancestors of Kemet. So that was our conversation. Now, moving on. So we kind of talked about this the last time we met, and we were looking at the X's here. And here, this is on some church or maybe a Masonic lodge window. And we see George Washington. He's in that post. And then when we look at this. George Washington portrayed in the comedic funeral scene. So here, and I first saw this picture during a presentation given by Astra Kwesi. And here, you know, they practice our rituals. Here's Washington's face, George Washington's face as a ba. What is a ba? See, the ba is one of the either seven or nine parts of the soul, depending on who you talk to. And these are the parts. So this is the part that returns back to the body. You know, it has the body of a bird, the head of a man. Here it is again in this situation. It's also associated with the ka, that's a part of the soul, and the ak. This is a risen, enlightened being. And here's another depiction that's in the Baltic.
Term per ah.
Yeah. Yeah.
Or what we call modern day pharaohs.
Well, I actually know. Let me just say that this ankh is different than ah.
Okay. Very well. Good.
Okay. So
thank you for clarifying.
Yeah, this is different. This is representative of an enlightened being. Yeah. But you know what, Philippe? We're all in varying degrees of ignorance. Nobody is a complete expert about
Absolutely
it.
Absolutely not. I don't profess. That's why I have you. Along with your ubiquitous clandestine informant, you are mine. And that, these ain't jokes. That's real talk.
So, you know, when you know your history, they can't fool you. So, okay, if you already know about Aset, Asar, and Heru, when you see this picture, you're not fooled. Or when you see this is the Per-Ah, here he is, he's got the shepherd's staff, the crown of the south. And when you see this person, you see that this is an imitation. But if you didn't see this picture on the left, you wouldn't know. Or this one here. This is from West Africa. They're wearing our symbols.
Would you look at that family? It's right there in front of us. They have no culture. They had to appropriate ours and place themselves on top of a culture. So, and you only steal what's valuable.
So among Catholics, that pose is called genuflecting.
That's right.
You know, so when you come before the altar, you go down in this pose. But you can see where the concepts come from. They tell us we don't have any history while building the foundations of their institution on our spiritual concepts. Now they're banning the teaching of it in schools. So if you look at what's going on in Florida, and then now in Arkansas. But here in Sacramento at Underground Books, they're selling banned books. The 1619 Project, Invisible Man by Ralph Ellison, and other books. So this, to me, Philippe, this is one of the most profound symbols that they've taken. This is it for me. This one right here.
Absolutely.
You know, but if you didn't know this one on the left, you just go on.
Absolutely.
I want to give special thanks to a brother that I've met. We've just met on the phone. You know, we FaceTime. I've never met him in person, but he's a kindred spirit. And I want to give thanks to this brother, Robert Belcher, and this is him when he was young with Dr. Obenga. And here he is again with Dr. Obenga. Robert is a professor. He's an archaeologist and the CEO of Expeditions and Research in Applied Anthropology, LLC. And he also works at Georgia State University. And here he is here. Now, this is I'm sorry that it's pixelated, but here he is when Sheikh Anta Diop came to Atlanta. And here he is with John Heinrich Clark and Dr. Asa Hilliard. He was very close with Dr. Asa Hilliard. Dr. Asa Hilliard was a mentor for him. But anyway, the reason why I'm bringing him up is last week I showed this picture and I said it was moot. And I sent the YouTube video that I did, and I said, "Hey, Robert, could you look at it? You know, just let me know what you think." And he said, and so he pointed out that this the way that this is presented is not moot. You know, I just looked at it, it's a vulture. What I was really trying to show was the similarities between, okay, there's the stars, here's the red, white, and blue, and here they're still making it. But correctly, he pointed out that this is Nekhbet. And Nekhbet was a patron of Upper Kemet. So I just want to thank him for correcting me. And again, like I said, we're all in varying degrees of ignorance. We're trying to get better. We're trying to really internalize, not just read and gloss over things, but really internalize what was being portrayed from our ancient past and bring it forward.
Give him my special thanks too. Thank you yes. for that, brother.
Yes. So yes. Caution for the next slide. Disturbing footage captured by a bystander shows the moment a white Minneapolis police officer pins George Floyd to the ground with his knees during arrest. So if you don't want to see it, I'm just giving you a little time. You know, you can look away, but here's the picture here on the left. Choked him out. And this is what Colin Kaepernick was drawing attention to. And then this is it from the other side. It was two other people holding him down. So this guy was keeping the people from the street away, and these two was holding him down. Now, Colin Kaepernick, just a little background. He was born in 87 in Milwaukee. His mother was white. His father was African American of Ghanaian, Nigerian, and Ivory Coast ancestry. They separated before he was born, and he was adopted by a couple by the name of Rick and Teresa Kaepernick. But here he is relating back to his African roots. And then I thought this was interesting. You know, Michael Jackson did the same thing. Here he is in Côte d'Ivoire or Ivory Coast. And Michael Jackson was given an African name, Aman Laman Anan. Colin Kaepernick kind of resembles a Russian icon of Jesus. Is it just me, Philippe, or does he look
I
like?
Just want to know, how do you find these? How do you find this? This is amazing. You're amazing. You're amazing, brother. Thank you for this.
You're amazing. You're amazing, my friend. What you're doing? We need to continue the eistery. We need to continue to let our people know. I'm going to stop arguing with people that don't want to know. I just want to talk to the youth and let yes. them, you know.
Same here. Ashe.
You know. So here, Colin Kaepernick and Dr. King on the anniversary of the march, you know, of his I had a dream. They're striking the same pose for justice. You know what? Even the Congress took a knee. There's Nancy Pelosi. There's Chuck Schumer. What's our vice president's name?
Kamala Harris.
Kamala Harris, when she was a senator. They're all taking it. They got on the kente.
You could have left that photo out, I'm just saying. It's hard to watch, but I needed to see it.
Let me tell you why. Let me show you why I put it in. Because okay, now
you're trying to make my hair grow back. I don't want my hair to grow back.
This is just stop it, man. All right, so
it takes a lot to stop Emo in full stride. That one stopped him. go ahead, Emo.
So here, the Congress and the Senate taking a knee, and but look who's here in the back. You know who this is? You know who that is?
No.
Anybody, you can put it in the chat if you know. This is King. Oh, this is Karen Bass, by the way. This is the mayor now of LA. So they all took a knee. They're wearing their kente. This is King Kamehameha. King Kamehameha in 1810 unified the Hawaiian Islands.
Wow.
This is how he looked. I didn't paint this picture. Reverend Shock Matthews didn't paint this picture.
Mm.
And white Southerns who settled in Hawaii during the 19th century had a song about the native people, which ran, "You may call them Hawaiians, but they look like niggers to me." From King Kamehameha to Queen Lili o Kalani, each Hawaiian ruler was very dark-skinned with Afrikoid. I don't like that word, Negro. Afrikoid features. It's one of the incredible ironies of history that few Americans are aware that the original Hawaiians were black people, and their royal family was one of the greatest in the 19th century. And this is a quote by attorney LeGrand Clegg.
Wow.
Yeah, and what he's talking about.
Great this, research, Emo. My goodness.
This was in J.A. Rogers' book. I think it was either in Nature Knows No Color Line or Sex and Race, where he talks about this song. So people, you know, white Southerners going to Hawaii said, "These ain't Hawaiians." You know. All right. Some parting thoughts from Dr. Wade Nobles. Sakhu, Sheti are two terms from Medunetcher. The word Sakhu means understanding, the illuminator, the eye and the soul of being, that which inspires. Sheti means going deeply into a subject. And I know this is something that you do, Philippe. I know that you don't, you're not a surface person. You go into things very deeply. So Sheti means to go deeply into a subject, to study profoundly, to search magical books, to penetrate deeply. Accordingly, I have suggested that the term Sakhu Sheti be used to represent the deep, profound, and penetrating search, study, understanding, and mastery of the process of illuminating the human spirit. Hence, in closing, I'm suggesting that the thought and theory of African psychologists should be governed by deep, profound, and penetrating search, study, understanding, and mastery of the process of illuminating the human spirit in its full and complete authenticity. Performing the Sakhu, seeking the Sakhu. Ashe.
Wow. Ashe, Ashe, oh. Incredible. Well done. Well done, beloved. Well done. Whew. All right, family. I really love that, and I am actually now, I'm going to incorporate that because I have a book that's coming out. It might be coming out this week. If not, it'll be next week. But I'm going to incorporate that concept now because what I love about what Wade Nobles did, it was more than just a physical gesture. You know, it's deep thought. And this is what, you know, I developed my own concept called shock seeking higher omnipotent conscious or cosmic knowledge. And now I have the origin of that. The origin of that concept is inspired by what I came up with. So this is what we do. This is what, you know, I wanted to align and lead with the greatest thinkers and the greatest minds of our time. And I wanted to bring the community, I wanted to bring to myself, but also to the community, the greatest scholars. And when you come on here every 2 weeks, every second Tuesday, there is always another, even if it's, you know, I don't know how many times you've done PowerPoint presentation on Ma'at, Netchers, we all hear it every day, but you bring such profound, deep research that connect us with the one, the original, in the science of memetics, which is what the island of memes was based on. There are three elements to that makes something memetic, and the first is fidelity. It's the original, the origin of an idea. It could be a word, it could be a sound, it could be a gesture, it could be a painting, it could be a drawing written in stone. That's the fidelity. The second layer or level is the fecundity, which is the replication and duplication. How many times can that original be replicated and duplicated in the minds of the people around the globe? And the third is longevity. How long will it last? And what you do every time you come here is you create what's known as a memeplex. You take multiple memes, multiple layers and levels of fidelity, fecundity, and longevity. And now, because you have replicated, and now using this platform, I'm the replicator and the duplicator, right? You're the fidelity. The community is the longevity. You see how that works? And this is how we maintain our connection to our oneness, to our wholeness, to our divinity, to Amma, and to our ancestors. And you're one of, and I know you are a very, very humble man. But I will say this. We did this event in Sacramento, and with you know, Dr. Nobles, Leonard Jeffries, James Smalls, and then I think we did an event. I don't know if it wasn't the same event, and I don't know which came first. Was it Kaaba when Kaaba came here?
I think Cabo was first. I think
I think Kaaba was first.
yeah. It
I'm
was
putting you in
Marcus Garvey. It was a
the
Marcus
Marcus
Garvey.
Garvey Festival. Yeah. And so, my brother Emo, I look at you as a scholar of scholars. I know you don't accept it, and you're not supposed to, Because you're a humble man, which is the sign of a true scholar, true elder, is humility. But brother, you are amazing. You are an act of pure nature. You're an act of pure nature.
Okay, stop.
No, listen to me. You know me.
All right, yeah.
I don't do this kind of shit. I don't blow smoke up people's butt. I don't compliment for, you know, I don't do that. You are one of our greatest teachers, and I just want to take the moment to give you your flowers and your acknowledgement of your 40 plus years in this, my brother. You are our Dogon. You are our scribe. You are our Jolly, our griot. You are amazing, because when I think of this understanding the science of memetics, and I'm constantly trying to figure out how do I amplify the science of who we are, the culture, the philosophy of who we are, and what are the research gaps that I need to look at and collectively add, you know, my two cents, if you will, to it. And when you come on, man, you change me. You freaking change me every time. Today I was changed yet again. And I just want to give you the love and the gratitude. I know when we're on offline behind the scenes, we joke and kid and all of that and do our things, stuff that we can't repeat on the camera.
Don't put that on camera.
No, we can't. No, I don't need to know that side of us. But you know, when, and we were in the green room trying to figure out how long have we known each other, and what was the first time that we met, man, and my life is rich, man, because of you. I have not been the same since I met you. And
I feel the same.
I'm grateful. Yeah. I'm grateful.
Well, good thanks, Woo! Man. I'm glad for the opportunity to share that you allow me to do that. And I hope that something that was presented, people will help people to understand the depth of our culture, our spirituality, our significance in history. And there's so many things associated with.
You don't do this for accolades. You really love your people. You really, to do research, to do PowerPoint presentations at the level that you do, you have to really, really be a part of that mayor, that unconditional love for your people. And I can tell you come alive when you do this. It's like you just really love it. And we love you for it. And we just want to say collectively to the community, from the community, we see you, we love you, we support you. Family, please make sure to go to wosesac.org. Wose, WOSESAC.org, and support this community in any way you possibly can. Financially, resources, everything. Because we take for granted when we see scholars of this ilk, of this stature, that we're watching right now for free on our cell phone. And this man is more valuable to us than any Howard or Harvard professor. And let us not forget that.
Brother Philippe, can I also add, so We have two, we'll say, locations here in California.
Yes.
And so the other website is wolsecommunity.org.
Wolsecommunity.org. Because you have one in Oakland, right?
That's for the Oakland. And we'll say SAC is for Sacramento.
Is for Sacramento. Fantastic. Mm-hmm. All right, my beloved. Thank you, Cedric. Agreed. Minister Imhotep, let me put this on the screen. Thank you, Cedric, for this. Minister Imhotep breaks it down in the most practical way from a scholar's perspective. Even I, as a layperson, can understand. Yeah, that's a gift, bro. That's a gift. You know, everybody can't do this. You know, I have my own ways, but I can't. What you know, well, I told you, like when I decided to go into ministry, mm-hmm. and I said, how am I going to teach? Because I'm a virtual guy, so I love being online. Mm-hmm. I don't like being in front of publics and around people. You know, I love people, but I don't want to be around them. Ain't that about, but anyway.
We're going to get you out of that.
No, you're not. I looked at how Emo would put together these amazing PowerPoints, and I said, hey, that's what I want to do. So whenever you see me doing a PowerPoint presentation, it's really a nod or an ode to Minister Emo, because he's the one who inspired me that I could teach online and make visuals as opposed to just be another talking head in a lecture. So, bro, you're the best to ever do it, man. So, family, let's give thanks. Let's give honks to this amazing teacher, this walking per ah, this living per ah of our time. And with the wisdom and the guidance of the ancestors, we just want to send you and your family the deepest love and the highest frequency for healing and wholeness.
Thank you. Thank
and
you.
And support.
Yes. Yes. Thank you.
And in our name, in Amma's name, nature and consciousness, we say, I am one with first frequency.
I am one with first frequency.
I am one with the first thought idea.
I am one with the first thought idea.
I am one with the firstborn people.
I am one with the firstborn people.
I am one with the only one.
I am one with the only one.
Ashe.
Ashe.
And so it is.
So it is.
All right, my beloveds.
All right.
You know, in the next 2 weeks, it's going to be another amazing cipher. We will see you. Of course, we'll see you Thursday with Dr. Clyde Winters.
You know what? Can I just say I love Dr. Clyde Winters. He has provided a lot of. I just bought his book, and I can't think of the name of it. It's right by my bed, but he's talking about the different tribes. I like what he says about the tribes. You know, the 42 sea pots. You know, so we usually refer to them as the 42 gnomes. Those are 42 different tribes. So those are 42 different ethnic groups. And so Dr. Winters, you know, puts the language and anyway, I enjoy
the linguistics and the historical context together.
Yeah.
Yeah. Again, best to ever do it.
Yeah, I like listening to. I've enjoyed
40 plus books. Can you believe that?
Wow. Yeah.
Can you? You know, like who does that? You know. All right, family. We obviously love you. You obviously love us. We'll see you next time on First Frequency of Oneness, Shock Metaphysics.